announcements we want to cover with you. You have the first couple here, so.
Yes, thank you. So today we are restarting our Faith Formation Team gathering process. So we have kind of had the Faith Formation has been in and out in the last couple of years, and we are trying to restart. So whether or not you have kids, whatever your level of interest or engagement in Faith Formation is, you are welcome to come to this meeting following lunch today. We'll be meeting in the Peace Room to talk about what we currently do and kind of our goals for what that future is for us for Faith Formation. So if you have young kids, if you're an adult and you just want to make sure that we offer more adult ed, come and talk to us and we'll kind of get an idea and a plan going and then go from there and see who wants to be a part of that ongoing group. So meet with us in the Peace Room. It'll be a great time. We'll try to get out as quickly as possible as well. And Easter Sharing Basket is continuing on today, so please make sure that you stop at the basket on your way out today. Grab one of those eggs. Big egg is a bigger item. The smaller eggs are smaller items, smaller cost items. And all of these are going to the organizations that we help support. And so all of these are things that they have specifically asked for. So it may be anywhere from salt and pepper to infant socks to all kinds of different things that are needed by the organizations that we work with. And we'll be blessing them on Easter. So please make sure and grab those today.
Good. Thank you, Beth. We also have our Wednesday night Lenten services that continue. Beautiful Taizé. If you've not experienced Taizé, it's a very prayerful, meditative service. Come and join us at 5:30, and John walks us through that process. Just if you need a little peace in your life, that's the place to be. Also, Church Directory Pictures continually will be continuing this week. If you missed the first run, you got another chance coming up this week. If you've not signed up, please do so. There's somebody at the welcome desk to do that, or you can do it online still. Either way you want to do that, but please sign up. You get a free 8x10 just by getting your picture taken, so please do that. We'd love to have you part of our directory, so please make sure you get that signed up for and show up this week. We also have a couple other things for you. Missy, tell us about Jesus Christ Superstar.
So it's that time of year. We have the next show for Once and Future Classics. We will be doing Jesus Christ Superstar with performances in May. We are looking for anybody age 11 and up is our goal, because we do have evening rehearsals. We don't want to keep little kids up too late. So we do have some minimal singing roles, even though it's a strong singing show, as it's a rock opera. You know, no dialogue sort of thing. But we are looking for anybody, any of your friends, co-workers, relatives who would be interested. We would love to see you at auditions tomorrow and on Tuesday at 6:30. And if you don't want to do that, come see the show in May.
And the show is held here at Peace. So come and be a part of that. They're really looking for some great people to sing. So come and try out for that, and they can make sure to get you a way into the show. We have a couple other things we'd like to share with you. The spam. Guess what's coming up next week? Oh, man, you're so stoked about this. I'm really pumped, because this is going to be my moment. It's Spam Cook-Off Sunday. This is your moment. Okay, now I have the best spam casserole in the world. I'm going to win this competition. But we want you to come and be a part of it. If you're going to be part of the potluck, bring your favorite spam dish or spam desserts, spam appetizers, spam main course. There's jalapeno spam. There's fruited spam. There's all kinds of spam. So come and join us. It'll be a lot of fun. Also, next Sunday, our conference minister, the Reverend Dr. Sherry Presteman, will be here to talk about our relationship and our series about what it means to be part of the United Church of Christ and the Minnesota Conference. And she's just coming just for the spam cook-off, too. So we want you to come be a part of the morning with us and celebrate the whole day. Please come and support her and our ministries. We're connected together.
So our next announcement coming up is about Drag Queen Bingo. Where'd he go? Where did Bob go? Oh, there he is.
Bob!
Oh, well, Just get ready, everybody. It's coming. Coming with Spam Day. So when you're here for Spam Day, you're also going to be here to hear more about Drag Queen Bingo. And I also wanted to, before the next video starts, wanted to say that this is continuing on, still a chance to get your Easter lilies and your tulips. So let's roll it. No, that's not what comes next? Fine. You're going to change it on me? We're going to talk about the Seder meal first. Then we'll talk about Easter lilies? Fine. Okay.
Everybody was aware, this year we will not be having our usual Maundy-Thursday service. We're going to be changing it up a little bit, and we're going to be doing a Seder meal that's going to be held on Wednesday, the day before, at 6:30 p.m. here at church. We're really excited to have some very special friends from B'nai Israel Synagogue that will be here with us to take us through this traditional custom. And so with that, we're also looking for people to help us in creating that meal. We've got two dates and times, Monday in the evening, and then Tuesday during the afternoon, and then our meal will be on Wednesday. If you're interested in helping out with that, please sign up on the church app or stop by and see me at the welcome desk after this service. Right now we're planning on having a matzo ball soup, and we're going to be doing chicken and then adding some other things that have to do with the customary hot. Yeah, but there's the term for it is haddock or something like that. It's a learning experience for all of us. So we're really encouraging families to come and be a part of that. Because of the cost of the meal, we're asking for $5 per adult. Children and youth are free, but we really, really want you to sign up and RSVP. Again, you can do that on the church app or at the welcome desk so that we can plan the number of people and with the food. So please come and celebrate the new the Seder with us as we prepare for Easter.
Yeah. It's really a great opportunity for us to really learn about our historic tradition in the Judeo-Christian tradition and how important this meal is.
So that means it's time for Easter lilies. Are you guys ready for the next installment in the Easter? Okay, here's the funny thing. I read through the announcements for this service twice. And I still can't get them in the right order. Paul,
so, yeah, I'll save you again, Beth. It's okay. So anyhow, so our monthly offering focus, we decided this year to break down our monthly offerings throughout the year so you could get a better understanding about what it takes to operate the church. We are looking this month at our utilities, what it costs to run the utilities for the year. Anybody have any idea what our total utility bill is for the entire year? Anybody, besides you, Debbie. Anybody else? $3,600. What else do I hear? $2,000 a year. $24 a year. $2,400 a year. It costs us $24,000 just for utilities to operate here at the church. So what we've done for you is provided an easy way to see what it costs per week, per month, and per year. And if you'd like to make a special contribution to help us reach that goal, you're welcome to do so. But more importantly, we just want you to have a better understanding about what it costs for us to operate this church, so you can be mindful about that in the budget. So the other part of what we're offering is a 5 for 5 offering opportunity for you that talks about our 5 United Church of Christ offerings. Pastor Beth is going to be preaching about that in the service today, but you'll learn more about our 5 for 5 offerings. Great display on the back wall as you leave the sanctuary. Information on our board, but listen to her sermon. It's really well done on helping us explain what that's all about. Now, Pastor Beth.
Now I get to actually talk about flowers?
No.
Okay, he did it that time too.
So we can push through that. We're getting closer on our budget challenge, so now we can go.
We are. If you want to talk to us more about that, you can share with us more about that later. All right, it's time. It's time for the video. Are you ready? Get set. Watch.
Oh, good, you're here today. Here you go, girls, it's $13, isn't it?
Yes, thank you.
Hey, are either of you getting Easter flowers from the youth?
I'm not. I just can't stand the smell of lilies.
Me either, plus I'm allergic to them. They are pretty, but I have to stay away from them.
Did you hear that? That's not good. They must not know there is an option to get tulips.
Hey, girls. How are sales going?
Okay, I guess.
There are some people that don't like lilies and must not realize they can get tulips instead.
A lily represents new life and the resurrection. So, I believe that is true for any spring flower. We need to let them know about the tulips.
Good idea. We are a church that is open to options. Lilies or tulips, we accept all flowers of peace.
So now you know why I'm so excited about this one, because it really does have the best ending line of any of them. Though Zach's cool, the first week does is pretty great. I get to be the one that says, we accept all flowers here at peace. So at this point during Lent last year, we switched from just having Easter lilies to also having tulips. And thanks to Lynn for re-editing these videos for this year so that it didn't say that we are now offering tulips. We've been offering them all year this year because we had such a great response last year. So get your flowers today. You can do it online. You can do it through the app. You can do it with the youth out at the table. It's just a great way to support their mission this summer and to have a wonderful, beautiful space here on Easter Sunday to really celebrate.
Thank you. Was it worth the wait to see that video? You know, so a couple other special concerns we're going to lift up. We did experience another loss in our community. Burton Hogue passed away. That's Sonia's husband, Diane Barker's dad. He passed away yesterday. His service will be held later this month on the 23rd. So prayers for the Hogue family and Diane and Diane Barker and the gang as well. Also, our own Bruce Adams. So we're missing our bass player today. Bruce had to have an emergency stent put in last night. He's doing very well and be in the hospital for about 3 days, but prayers appreciated, and I know that he is very thankful for this community. He just wanted to pass on blessings that he is doing okay. So we give thanks for that. So shoot up some prayers for Bruce as well. Anything else we need to cover? Debbie, we're good?
Good thing means you didn't sleep through it. You didn't have any problems waking up this morning with the time change? Yes, maybe, some of you. Yeah. Well, this week we're talking a little bit about offering. So tell me, what is an offering? What is that? You're giving someone blessings. Awesome. Any other definitions? What do we do when we take the offering at church? We give people things, right? So what do we put in these? The green papers that say that you e-give, or money, right? Or prayer cards. Exactly. All of those things are offerings. All of that is what we celebrate when we take the offering at church. Or money, yep. And so this week, we're going to be talking a little bit more about offerings during the sermon. And so I thought it'd be a good time to talk about what we actually offer to the church. So how many of you pass the plate down your rows when it comes to you? Or do you just let it be passed in front of you? Do you touch it at all ever? Yeah? What do you put in it? The green things? Does anybody put anything else into it? What do you have to offer to the church? Sometimes you might have money. What else do you have to offer? Prayer cards? What else? Is there anything that you can offer that isn't paper? Manners? That's a really nice one. Respect kind of goes along with manners, right? So when we take the offering and you pass it down the row, I'm going to challenge all of you and all of you as well to, even if you're not putting money into it or an e-give card or a prayer card, I want to make sure that you touch it, that you touch the plate that comes down your row, because this is about more than just the offering of money. This is about us gathering into one big body that's all saying that we have something to give to God. So I want you guys to come in real, real close, because we're going to bless these before they go out in a moment to be given up for the offering. Can you guys come up? I want you to, everybody to touch the plates. Get in close, 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 close. You're going to have to get in a lot closer than that. There's a lot of you this morning. Keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going. Oh, we still got a couple. Oh, Brody's in. Are we in? Nope, we still got more. Come on over. You can do it. All right, are you ready? And then we're going to bless the plate by saying, Dear God, we offer ourselves all that we have in return for your love. Amen. And with that blessing, may we also know that we are blessed to offer of ourselves as well. Do you guys want to help me give the offering plates to the ushers? All right, got to go to the middle. Okay, hold on right here. And you got to give it to those four.
Us to one another. So God bless all these gifts that have been shared to reach out to this world, to connect us with the world around us. And most importantly, let those who receive these gifts be blessed by them and know of your love that pours over them. We give thanks this day for your presence and your moment that you walk with us and those moments of grace that we experience day after day. For all of this, we just give thanks. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to share with you the scripture that Pastor Beth is going to use today. And this is from John chapter 3. Now, this is, for some of you, you may know the story about Nicodemus who came to Jesus in the cloak of darkness at night to kind of experience and try to understand what faith is all about. And this comes toward the end of this conversation that Jesus had with Nicodemus. And it says this. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, and whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that God gave God's only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they are not believed in the name of the Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. We give thanks to say for God's word that blesses us and holds us.
Thank you, Paul. For God so loved the world. One of, if not the most well-known scriptures in the entire Bible, held up at sporting events all over. And what is that verse? John, for God so loved the world. But there's so much more in this passage than that. This text is one of the most well-known, but it's confusing as well, and it's not as simple as it might appear. It gives us a glimpse of the divine relationship Jesus calls us into. The relationship that lifts us up and offers complete community. This passage, however, is often seen as a statement about personal salvation and the afterlife. Our evangelical brothers and sisters use this text as a test of faith. Believing in Jesus, the Jesus they believe in, and eternal life are given the simplest of definitions. But it's important to understand that it is Jesus who is making this statement. For God so loved the world. It is Jesus who is making this statement in part of a larger discussion he is having with Nicodemus, that Pharisee, as Paul referenced, that's coming to speak with Jesus in the dark of night, echoing the darkness in this passage. This is to Nicodemus, and it is to us. After debunking some of the religious leaders' preconceived ideas about God's love and the kingdom of God and the purpose of the Messiah, Jesus invites him to let go of his certainty of what he knows and to lean into the inexplicable experience. Embracing this new way of seeing the world would have been challenging for Nicodemus, who would be stepping outside of his identity. His identity is a man of knowledge and law with credentials and power and a comfortable social position. And into a place of newness, a new community, in which he would have to start from scratch and start from an equal space with those around him. He wouldn't have the power he was accustomed to. Instead, he would be invited into a new faith family. Not a family of blood, but a family of faith. So God loves and therefore sends their child to change the world, or save it, as the change, as it said in the passage. This change requires a revolution that ends hate and injustice and oppression and replaces it with justice and compassion and mercy and love, restoring the world to its original intent, from a world full of the evils of injustice to a loving, caring, just world. Therefore, this phrase of believing in Jesus has more to do with what we people believe regarding hate and exploitation and injustice rather than just an esoteric religious conversion. The question is, can we stay neutral in the midst of wrongdoing? Can we truly be neutral? It seems that John was letting us know that whether or not to believe and work for good cannot be a neutral decision. Jesus demands a stance, which requires active decision-making. To follow Jesus requires the courage to swim upstream against the strong currents that carry society's brutal ideologies. This is what Jesus calls us to do and what our denomination has taken to heart for hundreds of years. If we can stay true to that call to engage with the world because of God's love, we too can live in that eternal relationship. That is eternal life. That relationship is what we strive to support by our connection with other churches in the UCC and the National Church. That God of love. This is what we support by being a community together. So this week, as we said, we are in our Lenten series on the UCC. This is us. This is us, the UCC and you. And so we wanted to speak to the five central offerings of the church. And what better place to start than with God's love? Throughout the last weeks, we have looked at our history and our future through the lenses of who we were and have been in history and in our connection to Samaritan Bethany, what we stand for through the open and affirming movement and racial justice and advocacy work. And now we turn to how. The how of living out our call to follow Jesus by looking at these 5 for 5 special offerings of the National Church. And next week we'll do more of that with our conference minister, Reverend Dr. Sherry Prestman. So what are the offerings of the church? The United Church of Christ mission offerings give congregations a chance to meet people at points of critical need in their lives. They allow a common witness and make a collective positive impact. Our National Church identified 4 areas where critical human need exists. In places lacking health and educational resources and where disaster has struck. Within systems of injustice which oppress daily life and opportunity. In the lives of church leaders without sufficient resources to live with dignity. In the nurture of youth and congregations just beginning their lives of faith. In all these places of darkness, we are called to shed the light of our God. God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world's needs might be fulfilled through love of God. That's what our scripture says about us. And each of these offerings do that to help one of those communities. The Neighbors in Need offering supports the Council for American Indian Ministry, and Justice of Witness Ministries to support a variety of justice initiatives, advocacy efforts, and direct service. One Great Hour of Sharing supports partners in countries with ministries that fund education and agricultural development, emergency relief, refugee ministries, and both international and domestic response. The Christmas Fund directs financial assistance to retired and active UCC authorized ministers and lay employees and their surviving spouses. including pension and health benefits, emergency assistance. Strengthen the Church supports church growth, pastoral and lay leadership development, youth and young adult ministries within conferences, and is administered by local church ministries. And then this one, our church's wider mission, which benefits the full range of the UCC mission across the country and around the globe, to train leaders to work for justice, to engage with the world. This is the mission of our church's wider mission, because we believe in a continuing testament that changes lives through extravagant welcome. And while you may not be able to read all of that sitting there in the pews this morning, when you walk outside today, look at the poster and read it all. The gifts that we give make a difference in the lives of thousands of people. These offerings collectively serve to lift people closer to the abundance and wholeness in which Jesus has called us to work together to bring into this world, not into the afterlife, but into this world here, to ensure that we aren't remaining neutral in the face of wrongdoing. Rather than just talking about these initiatives, let's see what the UCC, however, says about some of these. This week, as I prepared for today's sermon, I came across the following video as part of a 7-minute video at all of the different mission offerings and what they are. So watch closely, because you just might see something familiar.
The home of faith in our United Church of Christ is the local congregation. Young and old,
anybody recognize anybody up there? It's a few years ago.
Volunteers and staff all working together to live out the gospel, to share the good news and prepare the next generation for their discipleship. The Strength in the Church special mission offering is received so that new churches can be planted, fresh ideas can take root in existing churches, and youth and young adults can develop their spiritual lives in ways that can sustain and inspire them to keep faith communities strong long into the future, especially in those parts of the country where the UCC voice has yet to be fully heard. Gifts to strengthen the church are directed to conferences, the local church ministry's office of the national setting, and the Still Speaking Ministry, which helps congregations communicate the God is still speaking message. Most appropriately, the Strength in the Church special mission offering is received on Pentecost Sunday, the birthday of the church. Gifts to grow on for a strong and faithful future.
So I came across that little video, like I said, as part of a 7-minute video, and I could have probably just stood up here and said, well, that's the scripture, now watch the video. I thought I might be a little bit more dynamic than that. But did any of you know that we're a part of the Strength in the Church imagery for the National Church? Have been for a couple years, apparently. I think that says something about who we are as peace. That an image from this congregation, this space, could be used to say we strengthen the church, and that that's a part of who we are, says that we really are living into being a 5-for-5 congregation. Meaning not that we just talk about these offerings, but that we support all of them. We support the 4 special mission offerings, and we support our church's wider mission through what we give, through who we are, through what we do. Because we do believe that God really is here, still speaking among us, because we do believe that this is the world in which we are called to act. Our church's wider mission, the Christmas Fund, neighbors in need, strengthen the church, one great hour of sharing, or if you use other words, caring for our global and local neighbors, supporting those who have served the church, and providing for the church's future action. This is what the church is called to support because we have found relationship with God, because we believed, because simply God is in this world with us and calls us to act for the benefit of all. It's not about what you believe, it's about what we all do together. It's not about having the right understanding of religion. It's about being in this together. This is what it means to believe in a God who became human like us. For God so loved the world. All of these ways that we live out that call to celebrate God's unswerving love of us. I said before that these offerings are the how of the UCC. how we can support justice, how we can ensure that we aren't staying neutral in times of crisis. Because our belief in a continuing testament, we are attentive to God's creative movement in this world. And we in the UCC like to make these wonderful statements. Our faith is 2,000 years old, but our thinking is not. Being 5 for 5 means that we actually believe that. That we train leaders, that we prepare people, that we are encouraged by the firsts of the UCC, but we know that it's not done. That no matter where you are or who you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. That we are never to speak for God, but to be within and around conversation with God. Never place a period where God has placed a comma. Because we believe in transformation, we believe the church's mission is changing lives. And we encourage and support our congregation and other congregations to do that change, to make this world new, to save it. We support churches. We change lives through advocacy. In the UCC, we believe we are a people of action, but to act means that we must be willing to move with the Spirit and to be in relationships here. And this is what these offerings raise up in our lives, ways to live out our faith. It's about entering the light as a way of life, evidenced by what we spend our time on and where we place our attention. It is about being the church.
In the course of each church year, our church-wide special mission offerings, One Great Hour of Sharing, Strengthen the Church, Neighbors in Need, and the Christmas Fund collectively serve so many who inspire our concern and awaken our care. Through these 4 offerings, we embody the story of our people, our churches, and all the good God can accomplish when we offer our gifts together in service to others.
In service to others, we embody the message of Christ. It's more than about money. It's more than about asking you to take out a dollar. It's about who we are as a people and what we will do with that work, what we will do with that call to the world. In Gregory Porter's amazing song, Take Me to the Alley, he says, "They gild their houses in preparation for the king, and they line the sidewalks with every sort of shiny thing. They will be surprised when they hear him say, 'Take me to the alley. Take me to the afflicted ones. Take me to the lonely ones that somehow lost their way. Let them hear that I am your friend. Come to my table.'" These words are what the UCC is about. This is what these offerings are about being in the alley, being with the afflicted, and celebrating that fact as a community. But rather than just hearing me say those beautiful words, I'd like to invite Thomas to share with us the end of today's message. Our call to serve is to do God's will, to show God's love to all those around us. For God so loved the world that he called us to go into the afflicted places. Will you please rise as you are able to join in this moment and to make your commitment to this place, to this world who is in need, because this is our church.
Make it what it is.
Others will feel welcomed.
I am welcomed.
It will do a great work.
I am work.
It will make generous gifts to many causes. It will be a sanctuary for social justice and peace.
I advocate for marginalized communities and practice peace and resetting of my life.
It will be a church that embraces all, builds community, grows faith, and transforms lives. Therefore, with the grace of God, we will continue to be a safe and inclusive church living God's radical message. And amen, because it all starts with us.